Hello everyone, I'm Helen. I'm an advisory CISO at Cisco some of my life, and I'm a youngest child of three, and I have a 22-year-old daughter and a husband, also childish. Anyone here have kids?
Ooh,
a lot of parents in
the
audience.
You came to the right talk.
We did. So that's me. And Samara?
Yeah, I'm Samara. Hey, how's it going? I am the middle child, so there's, you know, challenges and mind problems that come with that, right? Sibling rivalry. I've got four siblings as well, two of which I didn't live with, so there comes with a tooth, right? I recently adopted three kids. Yes. All at once. Thank you. Thank you so much. Yes. Yeah. If you guys could come every morning and do that for me, God, that'd be great. That I could use that. But yeah, so essentially what we want to do here is I'm going to talk about some parenting skills that I learned prior to adopting them, and then after, right, in the actual crash course, and Helen's going to apply it.
Yeah, I'm the old lady of the group, so I'll be giving you the seasoned, I've managed to get a kid through childhood and out the door kind of viewpoint, which was just completely a fluke.
So much wisdom.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
A lot of wisdom.
So we're going to start with why this talk, right? And one of the things that I've found as I've been doing the security thing for a really long time is your family at home is very similar to your family at work. And in fact, pre-COVID, I think it would be true to say most of us spend more time with our work family than with our home family. Is that true? Is that still true? Or does it feel not that way because everyone's working from home now? Yeah, it still feels like it, maybe a little bit. Yeah, well, so the challenge is this communication thing, right? And
yep.
And Samara's living this dream because she just got three kids all at once. How old are those kids?
Sometimes it's a dream, other times it's a nightmare.
It's a bit of a nightmare.
Yeah. Well, we got them when they were 4, 6, and 7. They are now 5, 7, and 8. So there's a lot of energy to go around. Thankfully, I have lots of energy too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a thing.
Yeah, they still kick my butt every day though. So one fundamental thing that we learn in our adoption training is the ideal response. And this works, he gets it. So it works in positive responses to things and negative responses to things, but it's very consistent, right? We want it to be immediate. We always talk about immediate feedback. It needs to be quick. Positive is easy. The negative stuff, right, we'll talk about that a little bit later. Direct. Be direct with your people. Kids can even, they start to roll their eyes. That's when you know that you're not being super direct with them, right? Efficient. No one wants to be lectured. No one. Not even kids. I love lecturing my kids, but they don't listen as well. They don't listen as well. Action-based. So when we talk about what they did, we need to directly talk about actions. How they can fix it. Actions. Give them something to do. A call to action, if you will. And then leveled at the behavior. You need to be as flexible as they are with their behavior.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And this applies not just if you're, how many people here are managers of a team? Ooh, so most of the room are actually managing people. This kind of idea doesn't just apply to when you're managing a team, it also applies to when you're talking to non-security people at your organization about security stuff, right? So we have a tendency, this is a trope, but there's some truth to it. We tend to think of our users as stupid, and we like to lecture them about all the ways they're not doing security well, right? We've got to stop that and get more into this sort of ideal way of communicating. Mm-hmm. It is going to build advocates for the security program if you do that, but it's also going to mean a lot less mental energy for you because, frankly, there's a lot of stupidity that you want to lecture people about, and we got to get past that really fast.
This is a perfect depiction of us before the adoption took place and afterwards, right? They tell you, they give you this advice to don't fantasize about what your kids are going to be like. Fun fact, when we matched with our kids, when I committed to my kids, I had no idea what they looked like. Thankfully, they're frickin' adorable. But when we got them, it was the picture on the right. Good God. They try to prepare you as much as you can, right, with the adoption and behavior frameworks, if you will, similar to security frameworks, but they never turn out the way you actually want them to.
Yep. The thing that's true about parenting and it's true about security is that none of them come with a handbook. And I'm guessing that you're probably like me, you get into security by accident, you end up in security and you run around trying to work out how to live and there's no guidebook. And you ask somebody a question about how to do something and the answer is, it depends. Have you heard that this week? Well, it depends. It depends. Parenting's sort of the same gig, right? So thinking about how you deal as a parent with unknowns and unknown unknowns is really the same thing that you do when you're dealing with a security program. So one of the things that we like to think about when we're running a security program or talking about security with our colleagues and the other parts of our organization is starting off with values, okay? Do you want me to jump into this one?
Take it.
Yeah. So values are sort of important because you help people understand the why of what you're doing. And from a security perspective, we need to be able to help people understand why we do what we do, but we also then need to structure the environment so that they live those values even if they don't want to, right? Same thing with when you're a parent, right? You set up, you've got toddlers in the house, you know they're going to stick their fingers in electrical outlets, so you put those plastic things over the electrical outlet so they can't stick their finger in it. So what's the security equivalent of putting plastic covers over electrical outlets, right? These are some of the things that we need to think about. So we need to put boundaries around what we do in security, and this means things like, what are our compliance rules? Like, what's rock bottom, we've got to do this because we're legally obligated to do it, can be part of it, but no one likes that, right? It's just sort of like telling kids they've got to eat their vegetables, they don't like that. So we want to empower them to want to do the right thing. And some of that's through recognition for job well done, some of it's by process changes. I will tell you, when I was a CISO at Ohio State University, we fished people, and by the way, don't get me started about fishing programs, I hate them, but at the time I thought it was a really good idea. So we fished people, and the people who clicked the most on this particular scenario of fish, which was about getting a PDF off a printer, was the HR department and the legal department. I'm like, gah, like these are the people who should know better than clicking on shit, and what do? They click on shit, right? But why? It was because their business process was, let's go get this resume off the printer. Let's go get this contract off the printer. Let's use email as our transmit mechanism for legal documents and HR documents. So their environment wasn't set up for them to eat their cyber vegetables. So we need to be thinking about what are the business processes that we have in our environment that enables insecure behavior and find a way to change that. In the same way as a parent, you know, you put bumpers on stairwells and stuff so they don't hit their head or...
Was I supposed to do that?
You didn't do that?
Oh my God, no.
Right. God. Right, yeah, you hide the keys from the teenagers or whatever you do, right? So we need to, in order to do that, you've still got to be helping them understand the why of what you're doing. So you want to be using language that aligns to your values a lot. So parenting words, you can see them here on the left-hand side. Security value terms, you're going to have to think about what your values are for security, right? For me, my primary security value is vanilla ice cream. I want my environment to be predictable. I want it to be the same pretty much every... I'm the kind of person, pre-COVID, I would park in the same parking spot every day because then I didn't have to think about it. It was like my Mark Zuckerberg wardrobe choice. Like, I wanted to be in the same parking spot every day. So think about what your security values are, and that's how you need to be talking to the people around you, both your immediate team but also the people in your organization. Why security? Does anyone have any value terms they like to use? You're allowed to yell it out.
Don't click on shit.
Don't click on shit?
Think before you click, I've heard
think
that one
Think before
too.
You click. Yeah, it's a safety thing, right?
Yeah.
Yeah? Any others?
Slow down.
Slow down.
That's a good one.
Yeah, for sure. Take your time, think about it.
I use those too, yeah.
Slow down. Also good for kids, right?
Yeah.
Slow down.
Well, I think what we sort of forget about as adults, we have too many expectations. We think adults should have a wider attention span. We don't. We think adults should memorize everything and be able to remember everything. We don't. We're moving on to the next email, y'all. So it's important, especially from a kid perspective, to have these short, my phrases, my parenting phrases, and the kids use them on me. It pisses me off, but I know it works, right? It's 3 to 4 words. Gentle and kind. Use your words. Don't use hands, right? So they start to understand that
there
and remember it.
There are some security people who could use that
phrase.
Yeah,
there you go, exactly. But consistency is key. Having that value baseline and being consistent about it, because kids and adults are gonna poke holes through them wherever they can.
Right. So one of the things that goes into this is understanding other people's perspectives, right? And we have a tendency to be really critical of people who do stupid security shit, but they're not intentionally doing stupid security shit. They're just doing it because their way of thinking and what they're thinking about is a little bit different than us, right? So if you're going to run a security program, then you need to be thinking about what it is, how people are showing up into the office as it relates to security things. So thinking about positive intent, right? They just want to get their job done. Now, an engineer getting their job done is a little bit different than an HR specialist getting their job done, is a little bit different than a CFO getting their job done. Our job as leaders is to help them to understand where there are things that they're doing that they really shouldn't be doing from a security perspective, and how security can help them do things better and help them work around those blockers, right? Do you have thought about that?
Yeah. I have somebody on my team. He's incredible. He is crazy smart. I have a team of 12, right? So we try to keep things consistent, documentation, all those things you're supposed to do. He loves to change everything. Doesn't matter. It could be working. He's like, I want to do this. I want to do that. Cool. You know what? If it ain't broke, don't fix it. I'm also I'm into the change, right? You want to embrace change. But I had to step back and I had to think about it. Why does he want to change everything? Why does he want to change everything? I think about my oldest, 8, he loves to be in control. So when he's playing with his brothers and sisters, speaking of sibling rivalry, he changes the rules to a game. I don't know why they keep playing with him, but every single time, every 5 minutes, he's changing the rules for whatever reason. He wants to be in control. So I think about it, and I'm like, okay, well, what can I give this dude on my team where he feels like he's in control, like he doesn't have to change every single thing, right? So we make up a project, he takes it and he runs with it. It's just taking a step back and thinking about it, assuming positive intent. Not that he wants to be better than anybody else. He just has this thing where he wants to control. He wants to have something. He wants to have something with his name on it. So yeah, that's exactly what I did. I tried to understand what needed to be met, how to give this person voice, because maybe in other projects he wants to change things and he doesn't get to, right? So he has to kind of conjure these things up so we can have a voice. Felt safety. I want to make sure that I touch on this. Another story time. I'm going to have a lot of stories. So not only did I not know what my kids looked like once I committed, they didn't know about me until the morning I got them. Can you imagine? 9 a.m. We put these board books together with pictures of us, what our house looks like. They see those at 9 a.m. They meet me at 12. 3 hours, they have no idea what their life is gonna be like. So we started with safety for 5 days, because 5 days later I had to get them on an airplane, 3 kids, never been on an airplane, up in the sky. They're running all over the airport. We played with them, right? We had routines already. They had no concept of a meal. I'm like, why do I have to sit down with you and look at you while I eat? This makes no sense. But they started to know what to expect, which is part of safety, right? Make sure your teams know what to expect from you, is essentially what I'm getting at. So. Yeah, so in that particular situation, because I forgot to mention it, I like to use I wonder statements. So this is something I think we definitely use as parents, because we don't want to tell them, go do that, because what are they going to want to do? The opposite thing. We try to guide them to the answer, what we're trying to get to. So we say, I wonder if that could be more effective if we did it this way, instead of, that's dumb, you should probably do something else, right? Or, I bet this would be better to digest if it was structured in this way, right? Because then people start to think, okay, well, she's just offering up a suggestion. She's not telling me what to do. Maybe it would. I don't know, right? So guiding to the answer. Some people, and Helen brought this up, it's a great, you know, as a woman, right, do they think it'll be passive aggressive? I don't care, right? Just, you know, you're trying to guide to the answer. If they make the wrong choice, experience is the best teacher. I let my kids fall on their ass every single day, right? And I don't say I told you so. I just look at there and I go, right? That's what every family, every parent has that look. Yeah, told you. So, got anything to add?
Yeah. So, I think this leads to this question of choices, right? When you're running a security program, one of the things that you're trying to do on a pretty regular basis is to get your organization to make good choices when it comes to security. And sometimes they know what those choices are, and sometimes they really don't, right? So the question is, can you structure the environment in such a way that regardless of the choice they make, you're comfortable with it from a security perspective, right? In a previous role, I had a function that I'd inherited, and I won't tell you what the function is, but it was a pretty important function, actually. And the people in charge of it needed money for the function to work. And they'd gone to senior leadership and they'd given them three choices. It was sort of like a Goldilocks proposal, right? So there was the, if you give us lots and lots of money, this is absolutely what we can do. And then there was the middle choice of, well, you know, it'll be good enough if you give us this amount of money and this is what we'll do. And then they gave them the worst case choice, which was, this is the minimum amount of money and this is what we will do with it, which was basically nothing if they got this minimum amount of money. Well, guess what? Senior leadership chose option number three. They chose the minimum amount of money. And the organization was ticked. Like, they're like, what kind of idiot would choose the lowest amount of money? Now we can't do anything. We can't move the program forward. We can't do it. And it's like, why did you even give them that choice to start with? Like, you can't give them a choice that isn't a valid choice. You've got to give them choices and make them feel empowered, make them feel like they're in control. Mm-hmm. But you, as the person who's puppeteering the environment, you don't care which choice they make really. You're like, you have a preference, but you can live with whatever choice they make, right? So we need to make sure that our environments are like that. So what do we do as parents to help them make good choices? Well, you can hide your vegetables in other food, right? So they don't know they're eating their vegetables. That's
cauliflower,
great.
Cauliflower mashed potatoes?
Cauliflower mm-hmm. mashed potatoes is a good thing. From a security perspective, can you incorporate security spending into other projects that they really want, right? So they're spending on security, but they don't really know it. They're spending on something, you know, the bright, shiny toy, but they get security along for the ride. Can be a really great way to think about that. Fresh food's good, right? If you're a parent, giving them something new and crunchy and full of flavor, it's really great they're going to do it. On the security side, maybe that's get them the bright, shiny toy, but in doing that, get rid of the old shit, right? So you're improving your tech profile, you're getting rid of tech debt. It improves the security model. But they're not thinking of it in terms of improving the security model. They've just got the new bright, shiny thing. Good job, them, right? Adding cheese to everything. Can I tell you, this works for every kid except mine. My kid didn't like the texture of cheese. I'm like, damn it. But it can be a strategy, right? So adding cheese to everything. This is finding security solutions that also have a business benefit. Can be a way to get there, right? I wish I had a really good example of this, but it just went straight out of my head.
Well, it sounds like you're bringing them along for the ride.
Right on.
Right? You're bringing them in. I take my kids to the farmer's market, right? They just learn that hamburgers come from cows. They're like, what? I'm eating a cow? Can I sell a hamburger? I'm like, yeah. So I take them to the farmer's market, right? They see all the plants. They see the people that work hard for it. They want to be a part of the solution. They want to be a part of it, right? So they start to eat that stuff. My kids don't like cheese either.
Yeah.
I love it.
So I just read my notes, so I remembered what I was going to tell you
Boom.
About here. From a security training and awareness perspective, can I tell you, people don't give a shit about your company's data. They just don't. Right? They care about their own. They care about their own banking data. They care about their kids not getting bullied online. They care about all of that kind of stuff. So can you give them a security program that helps them be secure at home, that is going to allow them to bring those habits into the office. And by the way, you get the benefit of them securing your company data as well. So things like, can you teach them about MFA? Can you teach them about password managers? Can you teach them about ad blockers on their browsers? Can you teach them how to configure their home networks so that the kid who does gaming isn't on the same network segment where they're plugging in to work from home? Can you do those kinds of things? It's going to help them be secure. But when they do handle your own company data, they're using those same things because now it's just sort of jacks for openers. It's just what they do, right? So it's not something additional that's going to wear them out cognitively because now they're in the office, they've got to do something more. It's just what it is they do, something to think about.
Well, it's making it personal for them,
right? Right on.
When Daniel calls Brittany, my brother used to call me a wig woman because my hair was so big at the time and it hurt my feelings so much. But then my mom was like, well, what if I called you the big fat baby? How would you like it? Right? And he's like, well, no, I'm a big boy. I wouldn't want that. Make it personal for them.
Make it personal.
So they can understand the perspective too.
Right on. Yeah. I can't remember what we're going to talk about.
I did not play this game when I was younger.
Oh,
so.
Okay. Yeah. So I think this was just, I have no idea what this was about.
Skip
Moving
it.
On.
Yeah, let's go.
Yeah.
It works.
Compromises. So one of the things when you're running a security program is you're not going to get everything you want all the time. And so part of the skill of running a security program, either an individual function or a whole organization, is the ability to compromise again so that you can all win. So some of it is being able to put options in front of people that you're willing to live with. But some of it is also making sure that the people you're negotiating with, that, whether that's CFOs or CTOs or whoever, that they're generally comfortable with what you're dealing with, okay? And we deal with this with kids all the time. Do your kids compromise?
They try not to.
Yeah, I hated
find
my brother
one.
And sister.
I mean, do your kids ever do stuff that seems stupid, but in the end you're like, holy crap, that was kind of smart, right? You don't always know what's best.
Right.
So sometimes you got to hear them out, find the compromise in the middle, and see what happens.
Yep. So one of the things that we think about is dumpster fires in security quite a bit. The challenge around security is making sure that you've got your resources lined up where you need resources to be,
yep.
Right? And this is also true when you're a parent. When you have kids, well, in the US, when you have kids, one of the first things you think about is, do I need to start a college fund? Because holy hell, you know, at some point it's going to be really expensive. But spending money on a college fund now means that you don't have money to spend now on other things. And so there's always this resource trade-off. So upfront costs, parenting upfront costs. I don't know, do you think we got it right? Date nights, doctor's visit, birth costs, baby stuff. Any other upfront costs we haven't thought about from
daycare.
A parenting perspective?
Daycare.
Daycare.
Yes, preschool.
Well, that's after the baby's born, right? That's an operational cost.
Mm-hmm.
Xanax. Yeah. So from a security perspective, it might be getting people up to speed from a training perspective. It might be bringing in consultants to give you guidance on how to run a program. And Xanax.
It works in both ways.
Indeed. So you've got these upfront costs. So as you're thinking about your security program, think about those things that are one time, usually, so not Xanax, one time, that are going to get you started. You've got the same thing going on with parenting, right? So we have a tendency, for those of us who go through the biological route to parenthood, we have a tendency to go, oh my God, I'm pregnant, and I've got a baby shower, and I've got balloons, and a pink and a blue cake, and a duh. And then you forget that there's all these costs that come afterwards. People do the same thing with security, right? It's like, how much is that MFA solution going to cost? Well, there's the cost of the buy, but then there's the cost of the run, right? So what are your ongoing costs? Food, clothing, utilities, school, lots of school, extracurricular stuff, birthday parties, whatever. But what are your ongoing security costs? All of this kind of stuff, right? So when you're running a security program, thinking about how much of your budget is startup one time, spend once and be done, and what's run time? And actually now, most of the vendors going to a subscription-based model, there's more and more stuff going to runtime and less stuff going to startup, usually, okay?
Yeah. Well, I have taken on some people on my team that are that come from teams that have no money, or the managers and directors spend the money poorly. So how I correlate this is, you know, foster parents get money, right, for taking on kids. My oldest was in a house with three teenagers, a 20-year-old and a 4-year-old. He was 7 at the time. That's a lot of kids. He didn't have a ton of attention on him. The foster parent, single mom, was taking all that money, right? But when we got his clothes that came with him, they were too small, they had holes in them. You have no idea where that money's going, right? So you have a kid who's not used to getting all these shiny new things, right? But you have to make sure that they don't take it too far. You have to make sure that they understand where the money comes from. So it's important to give your teams visibility, into the money movement and ongoing costs.
Right. I had an only child, and so they thought money, they still do, thinks money grows on trees, right? Mm-hmm. So part of the kicking them out of the nest exercise was also helping them understand where the money came from. From a security perspective, we'd have to do the same thing, right? People have a tendency to go, wow, security's really expensive.
Yep.
It's really expensive. Well, actually, compared to other kinds of expenses, it's not. Compared to buying a booth and the RSA show floor, security is just a penny on the dollar, right? So, you know, we've got to be able to continuously talk with our partners around what we're doing, and we've got to also continuously, say that 3 times fast at the end of a conference, continuously help them affirm what they're doing, right? So, SpongeBob, my favorite guy.
It's the best.
Yeah. So you want to be able to tell people that they're doing a good job, but we know that sometimes they won't. And what do you do then? What do you do when somebody does something really stupid from a security perspective in the office? I mean, there's the what do you tell your coworkers over a beer, and then there's what do you tell the person in the moment? What do you tell the person in the moment when they do something wrong? Yeah.
I mean, I try to have a very open door policy and say, I would rather you come in and tell me what you did or what happened and deal with it now instead of having you hide it and make it a bigger problem later. I try to take the shame out of the equation of it. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
So that they're not afraid to come talk to me about
it. Yeah, using my words.
I want them, if they're unsure, to come and talk to me as well, because I preach prevention and collaboration as opposed to reactivity and shame and
yeah. Naming and shaming is a bit of a problem, right? We have a tendency to really want to do heat maps and stuff like that in security. Which group is patching their shit fastest? Mm-hmm. You know, that kind of thing. Well, that's a word of affirmation if you're the fastest kid on the block, but it's also a word of shame if you're not, right? So thinking about the words you use and the way you're motivating your employees to be more secure or run more secure programs, whether they're in the security team or not, is super, super important.
Well, and you don't know what people go through on a daily basis, right? You see all these posts on LinkedIn where it's like everyone's fighting a battle you don't see. Be kind, right? It's true, though, right? As you can imagine, my kids were in foster care for 6, 4, 5 years. They've been through some stuff, okay? So it's unknown when you're going to trigger them. It's unknown when you're going to trigger someone on your team. So it's important that when they make mistakes, there is no shaming. We handle in a delicate way. We leverage I wonder statements. We try to see their perspective. We fall back on our values.
Yeah.
See what I did?
You do.
Yeah.
You went right back around.
Yeah.
Well done. Yeah. Values is always the thing. The other thing I would say is when you're leading a security program, though, one of the things you do want to do is preemptively let people know if you see bad things on the horizon, right? So you want to be able to say to them, you can make this choice, but if you make this choice, here are the things that could go wrong, right? Now, when the thing goes wrong, you don't say, I told you so. Well, you say, I told you so to all your team and over a beer and in the halls, and I told them so. But in the moment, you're not going to say to somebody who made a poor choice that is now a dumpster fire, you're not going to say to them, I told you so. Like, that's not particularly helpful. So you need to have a whole continuum of ways of talking with your community about your security programs. here's what we're doing, here are the benefits that will accrue if we do these things. If you choose to do something else because resources are limited, we get it, but here are some of the negative outcomes that could happen, and our job is to help you minimize those negative outcomes, but ultimately it's your choice. So our job in security from a risk perspective is to hold up a mirror to people and help them understand how pretty they really are in all the lighting that they need to be really able to understand where they've got blemishes and where they don't, mm-hmm. and then let them make a choice whether they want to walk out the door looking like that or not.
That's good, right? Yeah. Well, there's connecting and there's correcting, right?
Right.
We connect on the front end so that we can correct later. When I got my kids and 5 days later I need to put them on the plane, I knew there was going to be correcting on the plane. So I made sure that they felt safety and there was trust there.
Right.
So I could do that. What do we do under fire? You go first.
Under fire. Yeah, so one of the things that we need to be able to do is prep to be under fire. And I'm sure you all heard a lot about this at RSA this week, right? So what are we doing around tabletop exercises? What are we doing around business cases? Benchmarking, crisis management, that kind of stuff. So you want to be as structured as possible, and you want to give them non-risky ways of testing bad stuff happening, which is why you do driver's ed with teenagers. And it's the same reason you do tabletop exercises with your boards and executives, right? So something to think about. But sometimes crises are going to happen whether you're prepared for them or not. And again, if you've had those conversations with them ahead of time that says this is the thing that can go wrong, it's going to land a lot more easily than if you didn't tell them ahead of time. So as your part of your job as a parent is to help your kids prepare for things that are going to occur in their lives. Part of your job as a security leader is to help your company prepare for the things that are going to happen in their life as well and be there to catch it when it happens.
I have a good example of being under fire.
Go it.
Naturally.
Yeah.
So we were in the airport. It was our second flight, so they're like, I was already on a plane. I have to get on another one. You couldn't get it connecting, okay, from Alabama. So we finally, we get to our spot after everyone's eaten and use the restroom. We finally sit down. I was stupid to think I had a break. And Marshawn, he just, I see him looking around. He runs, he just starts going. And I'm like, what the fuck? True story, swear to God, I'm like, I'm gonna miss this flight and I don't know where I'm gonna go after this, right? So I had to rely on what I knew in that moment, right? I had to think about what could be triggering for them. I wasn't about to race up and grab him, right? But I knew where he was, I gave space, and I went, as you know, you rely on your training, the preparing you do before, so.
Yeah.
True story.
Occasionally, though, they do things that you would wish they didn't do.
I didn't want him to do that, yeah.
Yeah.
I had to sit next to him on the plane after that.
Right. So something's going to happen, and you're going to have to sort of work it all out, right? So one of the things that causes us security stress as an industry is we really want people to do security really, really well, and they let us down all the time. And it's frustrating, and it leads to burnout, and it's tough. But we need to have a checkpoint in our own brain that says, you know what, we did everything we could do to help them make the right choices and do the right thing, and they've gone and done something different. We'll help them do the cleanup and that kind of stuff, but we did what we could do. So at some point, you've just got to accept that stuff's going to happen. And yeah, you'll help them to recover from it later, but we're not going to own their decision, right? So we are going to sit down and be quiet and let them live the consequences of the choices that they make. Now, I say that as someone who's not been fired as a CISO for having a breach, and I know there are folks here at RSA who've been shown the door because somebody else made a really bad decision. Right? I would also say to those folks, also not your problem, right? Maybe the flaw here was you chose a bad company to work for. Maybe. Just a thought. All right. When you're a parent, you tell stories. Has anyone got a family story they know and love? Yeah. My dad died about 2 months ago, and at the funeral, people were telling all these stories and I'd forgotten them all. It had been so long since I heard them, and it was terrific to hear them. But we have stories that we tell each other about how our family came about, where our parents met, where we met, if we're parents or not. And, you know, there are these things that we bring along with us. Companies do the same thing. There are stories about... I worked for Cisco. How old is Cisco? My Cisco? 35 years. There's a lot of stories that go on in Cisco for 35 years. And there's stories that inform decisions that we make today, actually. Stuff that happened decades ago still informs decisions we make today. And I bet you've all got somebody on the team who've said to you, yeah, that's a really great idea, but we tried that like 5 years ago and it didn't work. We don't want to try it again. You heard that story before? Yeah. So we need, as leaders of security program and as parents, to be telling the stories that lead the organization where we want them to go. Right?
I'll take this one.
Go take it.
Parent-teacher conferences. So my kids, Daniel was the only one who had in-person learning. My kids grew up during COVID, right? They had never been in front of a teacher before. So knowing this, understanding the context, we go to parent-teacher conferences, and there's a lot to say, right? So let's say there are five things they need to work on. I'm only picking two.
Right.
They're not doing all five, right? But I'll pick the ones that are most important, and pray to God that they will outgrow it next year. So making the choices that are obtainable, right, and realistic,
yes,
super important.
Super important.
Super important.
So if you're going to go and talk to your leadership, whether that's a board or the C-suite or just the CIO and the head of technology in your organization or whatever, you've got to remind them of where you started, where you are now, and where you're going to head into the future, right? And these are the stories we tell ourselves as a family, right? Isn't this great? We're sitting here around the table, we're on vacation. Let's tell a story about when you kids were kids and you did little stupid kid stuff. And let's talk about maybe where you're headed in the future. What's your college plans? What do you want to be when you grow up? That's a story we ask our kids to tell themselves. Anyone know what they want to be when they grow up? Yeah, I have no idea, right? What a stupid question. But our boards ask us those questions. Where are you headed with security? If we give you this funding right now, where are you going to be this time next year? Can you tell them that? Does anyone tell them that? I can't tell them that. But we've got to be able to give them this narrative over time of where we're going with the security program and what it's going to mean if they come along with us on the journey, right? So something to think about.
Well, a quality that a lot of us have in security that is kind of detrimental for us but makes us good at our jobs is paranoia and anxiety, right? A lot of the people on your team are naturally paranoid. They have a lot of anxiety. Understanding where they're going is incredibly helpful.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
And I just like Princess Bride, the movie. Like, I actually think there's a whole bunch of parallels between Princess Bride, the movie, and security. Like, it does not mean what you think it means, and watch out for Australians. Has anyone not seen Princess Bride, the movie? Well, let me put it this way. Have you all seen Princess Bride, the movie? Yeah. If you haven't, have your team watch it, because all kinds of parallels for us to think about. So one of the things that we want to be able to do from a security perspective is show growth over time. We want to, little kids are cute, they're exhausting and annoying and you can't have a conversation with them, but they're cute, but you don't want them to stay little all the time, right? Security is the same kind of thing. You want your organization to eventually be able to stand on their own. Like, God, if we have to stand here 10 years from now and tell people not to click on shit, what are we doing with our professional lives, right? We have got to be able to move on from some of that stuff. So one of the things that we need to be doing from a security perspective is telling these stories of where we're headed, but also prove that we're actually getting there. And I would argue, if you've got an immature security program, you're probably doing stuff that other people should be doing, but they're not, so you've picked up that slack. Mm-hmm. As you get better, you need to give that back to where it really belongs. Right? Vulnerability management for me is one of those things. In the beginning, if you've got a vulnerability management program, it's probably the security team that is not only deciding whether something's vulnerable or not, but what order it needs to be patched in, and probably doing most of the patching and incident response on O days and stuff like that. A lot of that process stuff, we shouldn't be doing at all. We should be giving that back to the people who run the devices or the applications or the developers or whatever, and making sure that they're taking care of that in their processes and it's no longer a security thing. So think about the functions that you've got going on in your security program and ask yourself, should security be really doing that? And if the answer is no, find a home for it. Give it to somebody else. Even if the headcount and the money that goes along with that has to go to somebody else as well. Even if you've got to pay for the kids' rent for a while they're at college, but they're not still living at home, but you've got to sort of smooth the way out the door, do that. But make sure that what you've got in your security program is what security should be doing and not hobbies that you're doing because somebody else didn't want to pick it up. Yeah?
Yeah.
Anything to add to that?
I don't.
That was my
perfect
soapbox moment.
That was beautiful.
Yeah, by the way. So something to think about if you're building a program, what needs to go into the program. There's some maturity here too. I would argue that compliance is jacks for openers. That might be where you start. Understanding what your business needs are might be the next step. Making sure you've got good hygiene is the next step and so forth. But once you've got all of these things, then you can start going backwards through it, right? Have somebody else run compliance. God, compliance is boring. Apologies to anyone who does. Anyone do compliance in the room?
Oops, sorry. You guys know it's boring, right?
Super important, little boring. Maybe, I don't know. Work out what the value add pieces of security, compliance are, do those. But a lot of the compliance stuff can be handled by your legal department or your operational risk groups if you're in that kind of organization, right? So again, build up your program, but don't hold on to stuff forever. Like, one of the things we suck at as a security organization and a community is letting things go. Like, think about the things you do that you're going, God, this is actually a waste of time. Well, stop doing that shit. Like, right? Something to think about.
I've got a pretty good example.
Yep.
Crawl, walk, run. For the first 10 days we had Daniel, he didn't take a bath. He didn't want to take a bath. He didn't want to get vulnerable. He didn't want to take off his clothes, right? I get that.
Yeah.
But he smelled like holy hell, okay? It was gross. So eventually, right, we lowered the expectations. We were like, just get the important parts, right? You know, behind your ears, that can stay dirty for a little bit longer, right? First, he crawled. He just got the important parts. Then he started to do his feet because those were rancid. And then, right, we started to get all, now he takes a bath by himself and I'm a happy camper.
Woohoo!
It's great. It only took a year, so.
Yeah. So you've got to grow your own program, but you've got to grow the maturity of the people around you as well.
Yep.
And at some point, give over the things that really you shouldn't be doing. So with that in mind, some takeaways for you to think about. One, you don't have to be a parent to apply parenting skills in your organization.
No.
Most of us have had parent figures in their lives, whether they're biological or not. Learn from that. Also, think about the managers you've had in your career. Think about the managers you've liked, your favorite parent, and the managers that sucked, your least favorite parent. We all have them. Therapy sessions will be immediately following this session out in the hallway. But learn the things, you know, emulate the things that you like and discard the things that you don't based on the history of the people that you've had around you, right?
Yeah, when I think about being a people leader, I think about these three things and how powerful they can be, right? Empowering your people, giving them the confidence to make those choices, two choices, you're good with both of them,
yeah.
Right? Connecting with them. I know all of my people on a very deep, deep level. It's the only way I know how to approach situations with them in a delicate way, right? Is if I know more about them. Some people don't open up as much, but there are still ways. We have to connect before we start to correct. If you learn nothing else, remember that we have to connect before we start to correct. That's all for me. That's it.
That's it.
That's it. That's how I'm ending it.
So RSA has every speaker, you've seen these slides already, right? One of the things I would encourage you to do, even if you're not a leader in your organization, everyone's a leader, I get it, everyone's a leader, but even if you're not a leader in your organization, think about the maturity of your security team and think about the security of your organization as a whole in terms of the way they approach security and have an opinion about that. Because there's really different things you have to do to run a security program if your organization's really mature versus if it's really not mature. In the same way that being a parent of a toddler is completely different than being a parent of a 35-year-old kid. Different. Your relationship changes, your assumptions change, the things that you focus on differ. So next week, think about what parenting skills is going to get your organization, however you define that, to the next level. Is it you've got to build more trust with them? You've got to do more connection work? Is it that they just don't have the basic skills? They don't know how to brush their teeth, or they, you know, from a security perspective, or they don't know how to bathe correctly, mm-hmm. right? Can you help them with skills development? Is that going to get you to the next place? So think about what you should be doing there. In the next 3 months, though, validate your thinking around that. Go talk to your partners and your stakeholders and go, you know, I think we're doing pretty good at X. What do you think? And they'll go, yeah, no, absolutely. Or they'll go, no, I think you're believing your own bullshit, Helen. I think you need to go do something different, right? So go validate what you think you know with your organization. Why? Because one, you're in your own bubble when you're trying to run a security team and you need to get out of your bubble. But two, it will build trust with those stakeholders. If you go and ask them, hey, how do you think we're doing? They're going to go, oh, thank God, they're asking me because I actually think they suck and now's my opportunity to tell them. Or, no, this is great. I really like these people. They're great partners and this just proves it, right? So go do that. And then within 6 months, what you learn from those conversations, incorporate them into your programs, right? In the same way that you go to a parent-teacher conference with the teachers of your kids, and coming out of that, you now have a game plan for the next 6 months or whatever to work with your kids to help them get to the next grade or the next league level or the next whatever. You've got to do that with your own organizations and security programs as well. Anything else?
That was great.
I think we're done.
I think they get it. Thank you, thank you.
Does anyone have any questions or comments? Yes, sir. Yep.
To somebody who is CISP,
yep.
His responses to the majority of the questions were, I don't understand the question.
Well, that's a problem.
So here's where the conundrum lies.
Yeah.
We're dealing with adults, not children.
Yep.
So how do you apply this without insulting people by implying that they're children, whether they really are or not?
So in saying that they're a CISSP, you're making the assumption that they know what you know. Is that true?
The assumption that they're knowledgeable on this, basically, or they have a comprehension of the things that they're writing.
Yeah, I actually don't think we can make that assumption about other people in the community. My experience in the last 30 years has been my own path, right? So I did 10 years at JP Morgan, I've done 10 years at a university, I'm now at Cisco. That's a really different security experience than someone who's been in startups their whole life, or they were on the engineering side and not the governance side, right? So just because someone's got an industry cert like a CISSP doesn't automatically mean that they know how to respond to a survey that your company is asking them for. So I'd cut them some slack, number one. I would reach out to them and say, you know, let's have a chat about where you see the problem. And you're right, they might be a paper tiger and they somehow got that CISSP without actually having any operational experience and they're one of those. Okay, now you have the opportunity to have a conversation with that organization and say, you need to have somebody else bring in, or this is going to take us way longer because, you know, we've just got some basic blocking and tackling that need to be done. So, you know, I was having a conversation with someone, I think they're in this room, that was talking about Canadian hockey players are statistically more likely to be born in January and February of a year. Who was I talking with? Someone, Dave, was that you? No, somebody else. Why? Because in kindergarten, they put kids into hockey teams based on the calendar year. And when you're in kindergarten, there's a big development difference between a kid born in January and a kid born in December. So surprise, surprise, all the kids that get selected for the next grade up are born at the beginning of the calendar year because they're 12 months older and bigger and faster and stronger, right? So where am I going with this? I think there is a, we have a tendency to go, a CISSP is a CISSP is a CISSP, which certainly we should all have common language and understanding. No, we don't. We really don't. If I've been applying CISSP in Australia, that's different than your experience applying it in Romania, right? Is one better or worse? No, it's not. And as parents, we have to take our kids where we find them, and as security people, we've got to take our security peers where we find them as well. That's how I would think about that. Great question, by the way. That's it. Thank you very much for coming. Enjoy the rest of the conference.